Good afternoon. On behalf of George and the family, I want to thank you for coming this afternoon, taking time out of your schedule to be with the family today as we honor the life of Margaret Off. Today I would like to start our time together by just reading some scripture that I trust will be a source of comfort to the family and to all of us who are here today to kind of set the tone for why we're here, and that's to honor Margaret's life. The first verse of scripture is found in Ephesians chapter 6. It says, "Children, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and live, and that you may live long on the earth." And we've come here to do that today, just to honor her. Here are some of the other passages of scripture. Jesus said these words, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Let not your hearts be troubled," Jesus said. "You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions," or many rooms or places. "If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and you know the way." The psalmist wrote these words, "Wait on the Lord, and be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord." Another New Testament writer penned these words from the book of Hebrews. "Since then we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, who is Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to what we believe. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses, for he faced all of the same testings, yet he did not sin. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God, and there we will receive his mercy, and we will find grace to help us when we need it most." And then the last scripture I want to read for right now comes from the Apostle Paul when he wrote to the Corinthian Christians these words, "All praise to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father, and he is the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all of our troubles so that we can then comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort that God has given us." I want to take a moment now to kind of read some of the highlights, put in story form Margaret's obituary that was in the local papers recently. Margaret Ann Off of Tipton passed away on May the 21st, 2021 at Wellbrook in Kokomo. Margaret was born in Elwood, Indiana, on June the 3rd, 1932, and lived in Elwood and in Sharpsville between those years, 22 and 18 years. Her parents were Hansel W. and Mary M. Larimore Smith, and she married George Off on July the 4th, 1953, at an evening service, I'm told, an evening service. And he survives. And they enjoyed 67 years of marriage. And I've thought about that, George. Thanks for modeling that for all of us, 67 years. Margaret was a farm wife for many years. Earlier days, when she got out of school, she had worked at First National Bank in Elwood and Sharpsville, later in life in Sharpsville at the Tri-Central School cafeterias. She herself was a graduate of Elwood High School in 1950. And she was a member of the First Presbyterian Church in Elwood, and served with the Presbyterian Women's Club. She enjoyed helping with Bible school and church bazaars. Margaret enjoyed crafts, crocheting, reading, and certainly cared for George, especially in these last few years, has done a good job of that. Survivors, and I won't read all of these names, but just some of the highlights. Survivors does include her husband and then two children, Nancy and Ed, and two sisters. And as we read through the obituary, four grandchildren and nine great-grandchildren. And I think that's a marvelous thing, a great life story. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then after my prayer, there'll be another song of amazing, whose amazing grace. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for your word, which has told us that you are the source of all comfort. And Lord, we pray for that today for this family, that you would give comfort, that you would give hope and help. We thank you for the other family members and the friends that have come to this funeral home today to give words of encouragement and love. And so we thank you for those that have stopped by and those that are here today. And Father, we ask, we set apart these next few moments, asking you to help us, that we had sent your presence and power, that you'd guide our words and guide our thoughts. And we pray this in Christ's name.
Lost, but now I'm found.
When you look back at someone's life who's lived 88 years, we could be here probably a long time to adequately honor, tell stories, lessons learned of someone, but we're going to pause. We're going to look at her life for just a few moments, and as we honor her life and some of the things. I met with the family yesterday afternoon, and that was so helpful, and it was so good to not only to hear stories, but to see love and appreciation that the family had for their mom and grandma. And these are some of the things that was communicated to me, and as we honor her life. As it was noted in her life story in the obituary, she was a farm wife of 67 years. And as I said, I was thinking about that for 67 years. You know, the Bible says in the book of Proverbs that he who finds a wife finds what is good and finds favor from the Lord. And I'm sure that that Margaret blessed your life, George, and and that was a gift from the Lord. Any good thing that we have is a gift from God. She carried a number of names. I don't know whether you know that about her, but she carried a number of names. She, of course, went by Mom, Grandma, Great-Grandma. She had a number of different jobs over the years. As I was listening to stories, as the family described, these are some of the things I took away. Some of her jobs, she was a chauffeur, carrying kids around, and maybe I think later in life, grandkids, the different events. She was a chauffeur, taking kids to 4-H events and ball games and all that. And George worked a second shift, and so Mom and Grandma had to do some of that driving around. She was a gardener. Not only was she a farm wife, she was a gardener in her own right. And the thing that really came out in listening to the family yesterday was that she was a cook, and that she is known for her cooking. And her family expressed that, and in some of the other stories that were told, she not only again cooked for her family, but for the church, bake sales, and it says there in her life story, bazaars and different things I'm sure that she was a part of. And then some of the items, especially the chicken and noodles, with the thinly sliced carrots, was something that she was known for. And then at Christmas time during the holidays, she was known to be quite the Christmas candy maker. And as I shared with them, that resonated with me. My mother did that, and so certainly resonate with some of those things. She was a babysitter, taking care of grandkids. She was a caregiver, as George would need that in these times, and caring for her own kids and grandkids. She was a caregiver. Probably the most important thing, as I look at her story, is that it would seem that she was a woman of faith, with her church membership at the First Presbyterian Church in Elwood, and being involved in her church and church community. She loved her family, and as we reflect on a day like today, it's natural that we would possibly have tears, and the reason why we have tears are really because of two things. One of those is because we know, you know, the family, you know, that you were loved. And secondly, you loved her back. She loved you first, but then you loved her back. And so it was really nice to hear those stories of how she just was, I think, the word caregiver is what sticks out to me. Whether it was for her husband, whether it was for her family, her church community, she was a caregiver. Before we look into the Word of God one more time, there is an additional song that we would like to play. And just use this as a time of reflection, and maybe in your own mind you have some stories or things that you think of how Margaret's impacted your life. Use this time to reflect on those before we look at the Word again. The next song will be In the Garden.
Still alone.
When we lose a loved one and the reality or the layers of that reality begins to sink in, we're faced with the what now. And I want to read to you what I believe will be to many of us, if not all of us here today, a familiar passage of Scripture. And the reason why I developed this passage is I want to speak to the living now. As we move forward, a new normal will return or will come. And the point I want to get across at this juncture is that God wants to be the source of your comfort moving forward. And we find that comfort in reading the Psalm 23. And I just want to talk about each of these six verses very quickly. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The Lord is my shepherd. I just want to encourage you with that thought moving forward to the family. Allow the Lord to be your shepherd. This 23rd Psalm, probably one of the most well-known passages of Scripture in all of the Bible, was written by a man by the name of David. David would eventually grow up and become Israel's second king and leader of the nation. And he grew up as a young boy, teenager, in the countryside of Israel, and he was a shepherd. And he had a way with words. He was a wordsmith, if you will. And when we don't know how old David was when he penned these words, but David, looking back on his life, likens the Lord as a shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, or in other words, I shall not be in one. I just want to remind you today, moving forward, that God wants to be your ultimate provider. As you grieve loss, and as you deal with maybe loneliness and whatever adjustments you may have to make, the Lord wants to be your shepherd. And when he is your shepherd, you will not lack anything. And David could write these words, and as he pictures the life of a shepherd and sheep, he says in the next verses, "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul." For those of us who call Tipton County our home, we have a lot of green pastures this time of year, don't we? Maybe the corn's starting to peek up through the ground. The winter wheat is luscious green with its heads. "He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." That's adequate care for a sheep. That's a great place for the shepherd to lead his sheep, to feed. "He restores my soul." God is in the restoration business. And as you deal with loss, and as you grieve your loss, just remember, God wants to restore you. He leads you. He wants to lead you in paths of righteousness. Righteousness is think of it as a word that something like rightness. He wants to lead you in paths of rightness, to live the right way for his name's sake. If you're a Christ follower today, you carry the name of God with you. So he wants to lead you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And then he says in verse 4, he says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death." There are times we have to walk through valleys, and this would be one of them for sure. "But yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear evil." I have not personally counted all of this, but I've been told more than once by a lot of Bible scholars that the Bible says this phrase, or much like it, do not fear, 365 times. 365 times the Bible says, do not fear. And I've been told that one of the reasons for that is because we can read those verses one day for every day of the year. Do not fear. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. And then he tells us why in the second half of the verse. For you, God, for you are with me. And one of my prayers for you, George, and for the rest of the family today would be, as you would move forward now into your new normal, is that you wouldn't fear, but that you would sense the presence of the loving God. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me. I want to pause there. A shepherd in ancient times would carry a shepherd's staff. We've seen pictures probably maybe in churches where Jesus has a staff as our great shepherd. A real shepherd would carry a stick. It's nothing more than what a staff is. It's a rod or a staff. But there are two purposes for a shepherd to carry a big stick. One is to fight off wild animals. And a shepherd would have to do that to defend himself or defend the sheep from wild animals on the countryside. And a rod or a staff, guess what, is also a disciplinary tool. We won't have a show of hands here, but George and Margaret probably had to have some discipline in the home from time to time, right? Yeah, he's smiling. There you go. And so are the kids. Yes, most of us, if not all of us, have been on the receiving end of the rod, right? So a shepherd would carry a rod to protect himself, protect the sheep, and it's also a disciplinary tool when we sometimes need that. And sometimes God has to do that to us too, spiritually, to make sure that we stay in line. But there's a third purpose that a shepherd would use a rod, the same stick. So he's defending, he's disciplining, and sometimes the shepherd would use the rod actually as an instrument of affection to pet the sheep with. And so knowing that, knowing David as a shepherd when he was a younger person, let me read to you these words, and God wants to do these things for us. Though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for you're with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. God sometimes has to protect us. Sometimes he has to discipline us. And all the time, he loves us. The next verse. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Sometimes God has to stand up for us. I'm glad when he does that for us. Part of that protection. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. My enemies get to watch me enjoy good things. And then this last one. You anoint my head with oil. That anointing your head with oil, that is a tradition, a cultural thing that we probably don't do this much in the West. But anointing in ancient times, and you still see this in the Far East, is that when somebody would come and arrive as a guest into someone's home, maybe a long trip, our culture, when we invite somebody into our home, we would say, hey, the bathroom's down the right, you might want to wash your hands, wash your face, kind of freshen yourself up before we have dinner if you're having a guest in your home. In ancient times, and still in the Far East today, anointing your head with olive oil is a means of refreshing, it's cleaning up, it's a means of putting a perfume. I used to serve as a missionary in Asia, and so I've seen a little bit of this myself. God wants to anoint our head with oil. He wants to refresh us. He wants to clean us up. And then last, he ends with this last verse. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I'll repeat that. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And that's where God wants to bring us, is that where goodness and mercy shall follow us all of our days, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. 88 years Margaret Off lived on this planet. She loved her God, loved her family, and she can say today, surely goodness and mercy has followed her all the days of her life. And now she can say, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so I encourage you with these words today, maybe at a later time, whether it's a day later or next week or next month, I invite you to take your Bible or a Bible app on your phone and reread Psalm 23. The Lord wants to be our shepherd. And when he is our shepherd, we lack no good thing. I'm going to close in prayer. And then after my prayer, there'll be a final song. And that song is entitled Church in the Wildwood. And if I understand this right, this was a song that was played in the family car often. Is that right? I think. And so the family has selected this on purpose to celebrate mom's life today. And so enjoy this song after my prayer. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you're the great shepherd. Thank you that you want to be our shepherd. Thank you for paying the price on the cross so that we can be in right relationship with you. Lord, we thank you for the life of Margaret Off today. And Lord, the tears and our grief, we're so glad that she loved us, she loved her family, and I know that her family loved her. And so Lord, those expressions today are real and tender, and that is perfectly all right. And so Lord, moving forward, may you be the shepherd of this family, Father, we pray. And we ask this in your name, amen. After the song, then we'll be dismissed by the funeral staff. Before we do the committal, and then we'll close in prayer, I want to read to you one last portion of scripture. It says, for this slight momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory that's beyond all comparison.
because we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient and temporary, but the things that are unseen are eternal. For as much as the spirit of this departed loved one has returned to God who gave it, we therefore tenderly commit her body to the ground, in the sure trust and the certain hope, in the power and love of Christ our Lord, at whose divine call that they that sleep in him shall one day, rise again to stand with him, and hear with all the saints the welcome summons. Enter into your master's joy, for his is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we conclude this service, but we know that your spirit will continue to lead this family and guide them. And Lord, as we talked about how you want to be our shepherd, we pray that that would continue to ring true in each and every heart that is here. Now, Lord, be with us as we go. Be with us in the days that are ahead, that your peace and your grace would be sufficient. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.